Good evening, everyone, and welcome to AZ500 webinar, guys. And in this particular session, guys, we're going to cover the overview, what we will be completing in this particular training, right? So what is this course all about? How to approach and how to crack for this Azure AZ500 examination? And this is regarding what we usually cover in this exam, right? So we have two particular slides that I'll just go ahead and show you. And we'll talk about what are the areas of the security that we will be covering in this particular training. Okay, so I think we can start. We have ample amount of the people, guys. And before this particular webinar, guys, anyone have any doubt, any queries, do let me know. I request you all, please be on mute if you're not asking any question. If you don't have any queries, please keep mics on mute. And apart from that, guys, in case if you have any questions, feel free to reach out. So guys, before we are starting the session, any questions that you have, any particular doubts related to the course, anything that you would like to clear up, please let me know.
Hello, Sandeep.
Yeah, hello.
Oh, okay. So my name is Andrew, and I want to find out, it's my first time joining Azure, any form of Azure training. So I'm more like a beginner.
Okay. No problem.
Yeah. Will I still be able to sail through this course?
Okay. See, with this particular course, as we say, that security is a very big, perspective. I mean, there are different kind of the security that we have. We have security related to the network. We have security related to the Azure Active Directory, right? We have security related to the platform. We have security related to the data encryption, right? So the expectation with this particular course is that you should have an understanding that what kind of a security that you needed at what duration of time and what you could have approached from the Azure side, right? So this training is about Azure capability, that how you will be able to implement that. Guys, I request you all, if you are not asking the question, guys, please go on mute, guys. Thank you very much. Yeah, Andrew, go ahead. Andrew, I'm audible.
Oh, okay. So I was muted. I think this was forwarded to us. And so maybe after today's session, I'll know which area to focus on.
No problem. Yep. Okay, guys. Anyone else have any questions, any doubts? Okay, guys. So let's start our session. So guys, what is this course about? That is for AZ500, right? So guys, in this particular course, basically, guys, we have different layers of the security, right? And as we are using Azure, definitely we are introducing, or what we can say, we are allowing Microsoft to help us in order to manage our security requirements, right? So we need to know, guys, that what kind of the security that Microsoft can help us in order to design our infrastructure on cloud, or maybe if we are using platform as a service, so what all things that we will be able to use in order to manage the security, guys. So in this particular course agenda, guys, what we actually cover is regarding your managing your identity access management, how you will be able to manage your role-based access control, how you are able to authenticate any particular resource, right, or any particular user, and how you will be able to manage all those users in order to handle your identity. So guys, this is what we actually cover in day one module. Apart from that, guys, everything will be the part of the platform security. So like, if we talk about network security, right? So network security is a pretty vast, guys. Now, what are the things that you will have in your network security, guys, that we can have our network security groups at a subnet level, how you will be able to protect your networks, how you will be able to use your firewall settings in order to manage your security over there, right? So these are the things that we will be learning in your network security. So starting from module one, guys, configuring your Azure Active Directory, privilege identity access management. And guys, guys, I request you all, please mute yourself, guys, because I'm keep on hearing the background sounds, guys. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, guys. So guys, in this particular course, We are going to talk about the identity security, that is your Azure Active Directory, and also regarding your platform security, where we have the networking, right? In terms of your securing your infrastructure, in terms of your networking, guys. So talking about your network security group, where you will have your layer 4 level of the security, that with the help of your source port, source IP, destination port, and the destination IP, we will be able to manage the security. And apart from that, we have the security available in terms of the subscriptions, guys, right? So let's say if you create any particular resource in Azure, right, you required an active subscription for that. Guys, am I audible to everyone? I'm getting pings, guys, that, you know, this is something which is not audible to you guys.
Guys? No, you are perfectly audible.
Yes, audible.
Yeah, we can hear you.
All right, thank you. So guys, in terms of the network security, as we told about that, you know, that we can have the network security group, which help us in terms of managing the security at layer 4 of the OSI, that is on the transport layer, that on the basis of source IP, source port, destination IP, destination port, and on the basis of the protocol, you will be able to manage your network security group. Apart from that, if you required a layer 7 security, where you are, protecting your networks with the help of your FQDN, that is your fully qualified domain name, or on the basis of the URL, we do have a choice available, guys, that we can use firewall in order to maintain our network security. Now, what are these components? We're going to talk about in detail in a while. So these are a few things, guys, that we need to take care whenever we are taking care of the resources and their security. Now, taking an example, there are different set of resources available, whether it's a part of your infrastructure level of the security or it's a platform level of the security, right? So we're going to talk about what are the different areas and the components that we will be covering, right? So we have already have a discussion regarding your identity, which is your Azure Active Directory. So guys, what are the differences that we have on the on-premises side of managing the Azure Active Directory, right? And what are the differences that we have that we will be managing our resources on the cloud side? This is what we will be learning in this particular course. Guys, just give me 1 minute. So over here, guys, in terms of securing your data and the application. So guys, there are parts, guys, which is important in terms of managing the governance. For an example, if you're creating any particular policy. Now, guys, as we know that with the help of the Active Directory, you will be able to manage your authentication and the authorization associated with the users and the groups. But guys, in the same manner, you need to maintain the authentication and the authorization associated with the resources, as well as we can create policies in order to remain compliant as per our organization's requirements. Now, not only the organization requirement guide, in certain use cases, we may require compliance report associated with the ISO, PCI, and GDPR, a different set of the organizations, guys, which have the different compliance requirements. And accordingly, guys, we need to ensure that my environment is following that level of the governance and the security policies. So in the same manner, guys, we will need to know that how we will be able to create those policy, how we will be able to create those baselines accordingly, and how we will be able to ensure that my environment will be secure and we will be able to control that level of the security by checking upon the compliance report or by checking upon those policies as well. So we need to know that how we will be able to create those kind of the policies as well. And all these options are available in Azure, guys, that we will be able to create our policies and we can ensure that our resources are falling under those policy, how many resources are falling outside those particular policy and whether they are compliant or not. So we will be able to identify it. Microsoft has also provided a service called Key Vault, where you can keep your encrypted keys, your digital certificates related to your web applications if you're creating, or also you can keep your secrets, your connection strings through which you can connect your resources securely, guys. And in the last, where you are talking about the security operation, guys, so the moment you will be able to create security for all your resources, until and unless you are not monitoring your security consistently, you will not be able to evaluate whether you need to make any particular changes in your security environment or whether any particular resource that needs to be replaced, or maybe you would like to introduce some other models in order to fix certain situations, or you may be able to replace with certain resources which will be able to help you manage your security efficiently. So monitoring is one of the most important components that you can say, which is the part of your security, or let's say for any particular requirements, not only for the security guys, if you are doing a performance management, or if you are doing any kind of, I would say, resource management, until and unless you are not monitoring, you will not be able to know that, guys, which particular component is working efficiently, or maybe any particular component that we require to for the replacement, guys. So managing your security operation is the part where you're configuring your services, your policies, and with the help of certain tools like Security Center, you will be able to create alerts, and you will be able to ensure that you are following all the guidelines related to the security, what you have created or you supposed to follow, guys. So these are the things, guys, that we usually learn in AZ 500 course, guys. Now, closing regarding this particular, guys, any particular doubt, any particular queries related to the module, guys? Any particular questions which is coming to your mind? Are we good? Any questions?
No, sir.
Okay. So, guys, over here, let me open a generalized slide over here where we're going to talk about some of the security components which can help you in order to manage the security part. Okay. Now here, guys, we're going to talk about how to secure your network connectivity in your Microsoft Azure. We're going to talk about Azure Identity Services, and we're also going to talk about our security tools and some of the governance methods which are available, and privacy and compliance related to the data that we will need to take care. Now, guys, security, right? So guys, first of all, we need to understand the different layer of the security that we need to implement, right? Now, securing your network, guys. Now, guys, let me ask this question, guys, that with the help of the network security group, you will be able to create rules with the help of source IP, source port, destination IP, destination port, and the protocol, right? Now, guys, with the help of firewall as well, you create your inbound and outbound rules, right? So how your network security group is different from your Azure firewall? Anyone, guys? Why we use firewall, first of all? When I say firewall...
I can answer a little bit about that.
Go ahead.
So your NSD is a static firewall where, you know, it works based on the rule only. It doesn't do the packet level inspection. Mm-hmm. So if you want a kind of firewall which can inspect the packet and do perform a kind of threat monitoring as well, and it can prevent many sorts, packet level, by doing the packet level inspection, it can help us to protect the many other parameters which we don't want to allow inside the our private network. Mm-hmm.
So can we say that your firewall operates at both the levels, at layer 7, at layer 4, right?
That's correct. Yeah.
Right? So with the help,
we can say.
Right? So at layer 7, where you are dealing with the packets, where you are dealing with any kind of the data which have, any particular traffic which help your data to be available, right? And this is something that is, also able to help you in terms of your packet inspection. So your AI and your, there will be algorithm which will be also created by your Microsoft, that automatically if any particular packet, which is, though it is something which is allowed as per the rule, but if it's carrying any kind of the data which can harm your environment, that can automatically block by firewall, which cannot be done by your NSG guys, because your network security group works at layer 4, right? So it rightly mentioned that your layer 4 traffic will not dealing with your data transfer. It's only on the basis of your source port, source IP, destination port, destination IP, and protocol. However, your firewall can manage your DNS level traffic as well. Clear with everyone? Right? So that is the reason your firewall is your stateful managed as service and denied server access based on your originated IP to protect your network resources. So firewall features applies your inbound and outbound filtering rules, built-in high availability and unrestricted cloud scalability, and uses Azure Monitor login as well. So guys, what kind of the data which has been discarded, if you like to keep an eye on such kind of the requirements, your firewall can help you in such kind of the login managements as well. So you can capture your logs, and you can, you can track such kind of the problems, guys, that which is happening in your production environment. Apart from that, guys, we also have one more security components available that you can use, that is your distributed denial of service, which is your DDoS protection, right? So guys, those days are gone when, you know, people used to capture your servers, right, by sending multiple requests, and they were trying to create problem in your server environment by making your server engaged. How they are engaging? From different IP address, they are sending multiple requests to your server, so your server can become nearly non-responsive in nature. Now, these kind of a threats, what used to happen in year, what I would say, 2004, 2005, such kind of the attacks were very, very common, right? And guys, it used to consume the entire bandwidth of the server. And, you know, guys, the network congestion and those kind of a problems was pretty common at that duration of time. With the advancement of the technology, they introduced AI and machine learning. And with the help of this DDoS protection, this DDoS protection plan, guys, by default, there is a basic DDoS protection, which will be available in any Azure network that you will be creating on cloud. But for a standard, that is something which is a chargeable support plan. And that is something that we need to pay for that. And in this way, we can ensure that my network is protected for such kind of the attacks. Why? Because with this standard DDoS protection, we already have AI available, and they will be able to inspect that what kind of the IPs who are creating problem. And not only that, it can also track down the algorithm that what will be the next IP through which the attack will be coming in, and automatically it will protect your entire environment by blocking those IP addresses in advance, right? So basically, your DDoS attacks, which overwhelm and exhaust your network resources, making apps slow or unresponsive, your Azure DDoS protection feature sanitizes unwanted traffic before it impacts service availability. Basic service tier is automatically enabled in Azure. So standard service tier, add mitigation capabilities, tunes to protect your Azure virtual network and resources. Apart from your DDoS protection, guys, there are other components as well. Network security group. Now, guys, firewall is something which is a costly appliance, right? So if you don't require layer 7 layer of the security, or if you're not needing any kind of a packet inspection layer of the security, you can probably use your network security group for such kind of the security where your layer 7 data packets or any intelligence is not required in order to block the traffic. So for straight forward traffics that you would like to block on the basis of the IP, you can use your network security group, right? So your network security group feature sets inbound and outbound filter. So guys, what do you mean by that, inbound and outbound? So guys, whenever you will be creating a network, right? And whenever there is a subnet that you have created, right? So let's say you have given a range to your network over here, /16. And let's say you have given a range over here, let's say /24 to your subnet. Now guys, whenever you will be creating any particular virtual machine inside that particular subnet, your network security group can be created at a subnet level, or it can be created at a NIC level of any particular virtual machine. Now, depending on your requirement, if you would like to control the traffic of entire resources which you have created in the subnet with the help of that network security group, you can create your network security group at a subnet level. However, if you want to control individually to an individual resource, that every resource is unique and handling different sort of traffic, you will be able to create your network security group at a NIC level as well. So guys, over here, you do have a choice available for network security group, that your network security group sets your inbound and outbound rules to filter by any resource and destination IP on the basis of port and protocol, add multiple rules and needs within your subscription limit, and Azure applies default baseline and security rules to new network security groups. Now guys, what are these baselines? So guys, these baselines will be created by us. Let's say, for an example, if I go to Azure portal and if I create a virtual machine over here, so by default, guys, while creating a virtual machine itself, there will be an option available that it will ask you in order to create any kind of the security for your virtual machine in terms of your NSG. Now, guys, it's up to you whether you would like to allow any particular port or not. It's up to you, guys. Now, over here, guys, if you talk about a virtual machine, guys, first you will be selecting your subscription. Then you need to select your resource group, where in which particular subscription and resource group you will be creating your virtual machine for. And then You will be creating your virtual machine by providing the name and selecting the region where you would like to create your resource. Apart from that, guys, you will be selecting the operating system type and the size of the virtual machine that what you needed. Apart from selecting that particular size, guys, what you need to do that you need to provide the username. Now, apparently, guys, username will be the admin name. So let's say I will be giving my name over here. And apart from that, I can give the password, which I will require in order to access my machine, right? Now, guys, over here, you do have a choice available, guys, whether you will be creating a network security group where you will like to allow any particular port over here. So the moment you will allow any particular rule, it will create a network security group at a NIC level of your resource. If you want to create any particular rule accordingly, you can do that from here, or you can go to your network security settings through your virtual machine, and you can also decide that what kind of a rule that you required over here. So you can probably go into the advanced choices, and from here itself, you do have an option available, guys, to create any kind of your inbound and outbound rules at your machine, right? So this is something while creating your virtual machine as well, on the basis of source port, destination port, and on the basis of the protocol, guys, you will be able to control the traffic over here. So guys, the choices are available, and depending on your requirement, guys, how you would like to control, you will be able to control your traffic accordingly. Clear with everyone? Any doubt, any queries over here?
Yeah, Sandeep, it's Narendra. I have a quick question about NSG.
Yeah, go ahead.
So let's say I have an NSG, NSG applied at a subnet level, which has certain rules actually. Mm-hmm. Now, I want to override that NSG. For example, I got a requirement that I need to allow a particular port for particular VM. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. So in that case, if there are two things. Either I take that VM out of that subnet and put in somewhere that where that required NSG is there. Mm-hmm. But let's say I don't want to go in that discussion or that expectations. Mm-hmm. Let's say I'm just going to create a small NSG at NIC level allowing those ports. Mm-hmm. So will the NSG at NIC level will override my yes. subnet level NSG?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, no problem. So this is something, guys, that what we can have over here, that as I mentioned, guys, your network security group can be implemented at subnet level or NIC level. But guys, the moment you will be creating a NIC level NSG, definitely they will going to take over on the subnet level part, right? So whenever you will be creating a NIC level, this will create a separate rule because you are using a separate NSG for that particular machine. Clear? Now, usually, guys, we do have a concept of the application security group as well, where you can segregate different rules of your NSG with different application security groups so that you can group them together. So that option is also available. Okay. Narendra, you are there?
Yeah, I'm there. I'm sorry. I was speaking on mute. Yes, I understand. So maybe quick, when you talk about ASG, so what is the basic difference between ASG and NSG?
Okay. So the difference between NSG and ASG is your NSG is a group of incoming and outbound rules that you will be creating in NSG. However, your ASG is nothing. It's just an association of one rule with one application security group so that you can assign that particular rule to that particular machine. I'll give you one example. So Narendra, as you mentioned that you can use an NSG at subnet level. So if you're creating an NSG at subnet level, and let's say you have multiple machines. So whenever you will be allowing any particular port, it will open all the ports on all the machine. If you deny, it will deny for all the machine. Now, as you mentioned that I want to create it only for one machine separately, so I can create a network security group for that particular machine with the different set of rules, right? But let's say you have 100 machines in one subnet, right? Now, every machine wants different combination of the rules in the same subnet. Now, let's say if you have 100 machine and 20 machines want different kind of a rules, let's say HTTP, HTTPS open, another machine want RDP and HTTP open, another want SSL, HTTPS open. Now, with 100 machine, definitely I will not going to create 100 NSG separately, right? That is something that is a mismanagement, right? And obviously I will not be able to create one network security group rule at a subnet level as well, because that will expose my all the resources, right? So in order to avoid such kind of a problem, we use application security group. Now, let's say I have created one RDP rule, right? So what I can do, I can create one RDP rule. I can create one HTTP rule, right? And I can create these kind of three or four rules in the same network security group. Now, the moment I will be able to create these rules over here, let's say, what I can do, I can associate each rule with one application security group. Right? So your application security group is nothing, is basically a way of handling your multiple rule problems with the help of the NSG. So after associating your NSG at a subnet level, now then I can decide, let's say this machine want RDP and HTTP to be available. I can assign these two rules at NIC level. If I want this to RDP and HTTPS to be enabled, I can assign these two rules. Or let's say this machine want SSL and HTTP and HTTPS enabled, I can associate with easily, right? So whatever combination I required, I will be able to handle using the ASE. And if tomorrow I need to remove any particular rule, I can remove that particular rule efficiently, rather creating an NSG. So this is something which is another way of managing a complex mechanism using the ASG. Clear?
Yeah, makes sense. Makes sense. Thank you. Thank you, Sandeep. Thank you so much.
No problem. So guys, these are the choices that we have over here for your network security group and your application security group, guys. So this is, we have already mentioned that it provides for the grouping of the server with the similar port filtering requirements and group together servers with the similar functions such as web servers. Application security group features allow you to reuse for your security. Now, guys, your security policy at scale without manual maintenance of explicitly IP address. Of course, guys, otherwise, if you're creating network security group at NIC level, you need to ready with each and every rule for any NSG, and it will require a lot of maintenance, guys, because every resource have own set of rules, right? So handles complexity of your explicitly IP and multiple set of rules, allowing you to focus on your business logic. So of course, it is the ease of management that we have already discussed, guys. Any questions, any doubt related to your firewall, network security group, application security group, guys, do let me know. All good, guys? Any confusion?
No, sir.
Okay. Now, guys, here in this particular picture, what we are seeing over here, guys, that is your defense in depth model. Now, what do you mean by defense in depth over here? Guys, every layer of the security requires different mechanism. For example, if I say physical security, right? So, guys, what do you understand from physical security? If I say physical security, right? So guys, let's say you are purchasing your laptop for an example, right? On that particular laptop, you have created your server, right? If I take an example of the physical security of that particular laptop, so what does that mean? It means your laptop has to be secure, right? In the same manner, if you are using Azure, right? You are creating your virtual machine or you are creating your resources, where those resources are getting created? Those resources are getting created somewhere in Microsoft data centers, right? If I create a network or if I create a firewall or if I create any resource, right? That is getting created where? In Azure data center, right? So over here, guys, if I go to azure.com, let's say. Right? Just go to azure.com and just go to regions that Microsoft has created already for all this. So these are data center region, guys. So guys, Microsoft provides more than 60 plus regions where you can select areas where you can create your resources, guys. Right? These are your data center regions which are available, guys. 60 plus region, more than any particular provider, guys. So these are some of the areas and the regions available, guys, that you can pick in order to create resources. Now, if I select any region, what does that mean? That whatever resource I'll be creating that will be getting created in one of the data center which will be created by Microsoft in that region. Are you getting my point? So at the end of the day, if you will be creating any particular resource in any region of Microsoft in the data center, so what will be the part of the physical security over here? That means your data center security. Now, guys, in 99.99%, Microsoft will be managing your data center level of the security until and unless you are using your own private data center for the resource creation. Clear? So at the end of the day, resources are getting created in Azure data center. So physical security will be managed by whom? Guys, who is responsible for the physical security?
Microsoft.
Yeah, Microsoft.
Right. Now, second layer of the security, guys, is your identity and access management. Now, what do you mean by identity access management? Whom you have given what kind of a role? Let's say if you have assigned any particular role to any particular user as an owner, contributor, or as a reader, right? Who will be responsible for that? So guys, your identity and access management totally under your control, your administrator or your global administrator, who will be taking care of your authentication and authorization, right? Now, who will be responsible for this? We are, right? So as your identity and access management will be totally our responsibility, because if somebody, I have given a role as an administrator, and if there is any security breach happened, because that particular person is trying to access any particular data, which will be customer sensitive information or any action like that, which can create problem in the environment. So that is our responsibility. We shouldn't have provided that particular role to those kind of the user. So guys, always remember, when you're dealing with the security deals with your zero trust model. It means people who are supposed to work on the resource only need to be given that particular resource. So a person who can manage the resources, and you don't want to give any particular action that a user can add or delete. So you will not give them the administrator role. You will only give them contributor or a reader role. Am I clear? Is it clear with everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, guys, further is called perimeter level of the security. So a few minutes ago, guys, we were talking about DDoS protection and your firewall, where the things are there that, you know, it is going to inspect your packet, or it will automatically able to detect the IP and block. So those kind of the IP. So, guys, these required AI and machine learning algorithms in the backend so that it will be able to protect your resources accordingly. And that is the reason your firewall and your DDoS protection will be the part of your perimeter level of the security. Now, taking an example of your network level of the security. So your NSG and your application security group is the part of network security. Right? So perimeter level of the security, if I talk about firewall, we are the one who will be creating rule, but who will be doing the packet inspection? Again, it's an AI created by Microsoft. So guys, we are responsible in the perimeter level of the security in terms of creating the rules. But in the back end, when it comes to your packet inspection, when it comes to your DDoS protection, Microsoft will be the one who will be managing it. So you can say that there's a kind of a shared responsibility where we are responsible in order to create rules, or in terms of whether we will be using basic or a standard DDoS plan. However, Microsoft is responsible in order to manage the algorithm or managing AI, which will help us in order to inspect packet or in order to identify bad IPs during the DDoS protection. Clear with everyone? Yeah. And network security group is something which is totally under our control, because with the help of source IP, source port, destination IP, destination port, we are the one who will be deciding that what kind of a traffic should be allowed or what kind of the protocols we will be using, right? So your network security and your application security group, which is the part of your network security, is under our control. Clear with everyone? Guys, are we clear with the physical identity access management perimeter and network security over here?
Clear.
Yeah. So yes, that is a layered approach, guys. Now, compute level of the security. So first of all, guys, what is compute? What do you understand from compute over here? Quickly, guys. What is the compute?
It is your memory, RAM, or storage. Anything's possible.
Memory, RAM of the storage. So basically, we are talking about the performance tier, right? Through which you will be able to get some performance, right? Number of virtual cores that you are using, number of CPUs that you will be using, right? So this is your performance tier on the basis of the compute. Now guys, over here, how you access your Azure portal? Over HTTP and HTTPS, isn't it? So if I say HTTPS, it means it's encrypted. So a user who will try to access the portal in order to create the resources, it's a secure connection, isn't it? Yes. Over HTTPS, right? So a secure certificate is used over here before I can go ahead and create my resources, right? Now, what happened, guys, after creating your resources securely over here? After accessing it, we are here in order to select our resources over here, whatever we will be creating, right? Now, how the things are getting created? Guys, there is a compute which will be required, right? And in the backend, everything is your Azure Resource Manager. We call it ARM, right? And there will be a template which will help us creating the resources in back to the data center of the Microsoft. Now, how these resources are getting created, guys? Whatever selection you are doing on the portal, how the resources are getting created in the backend, we have something called your fabric controller in the backend over here. And which is created by Microsoft. So guys, in terms of compute of any resource, right? If you are creating a VM, that compute is there, that is fine. But over here in the selection, whatever selection of the resources you will be doing, in the backend, those resources are getting created with the help of the compute, right? And over here, those compute will be provided by your resource manager, which is created by Azure. And in the backend, everything is a runbook over here, right? So that process has been automated, which helps you creating your resources with the help of the portal. Are we clear? So the moment I will click create a machine over here, let's say I'm creating a virtual machine for an example. And the moment I will be hitting, let's say I'll just create a resource group with the name RG, and I create a virtual machine over here, VM in East US for an example. Yeah. And the moment I will be creating a virtual machine in the East US, what will happen, guys? The moment I will click on review and create, it will start creating the resources. And in the East US data center, this resources will be deployed. Now, how this resource will deploy from this particular trigger? So basically in the backend, definitely a compute mechanism has been introduced. Now, guys, whatever compute which is going on over here, this can be also intruded, isn't it? What if somebody is going to modify my request? What I'm submitting from here, that request can be modifiable in the backend as well, right? Now, who need to manage this particular security by the time my resources are getting created from here to a data center in East US? Who is managing the security, guys?
Microsoft.
Clearly Microsoft, right? So this compute level of the security will be managed by Microsoft, right? Now, let's take an example of the application and the data. So guys, if you are using platform as a service, or if I say if you are using infrastructure as a service, let's say this is your VM, and inside VM, you will have your environment and the operating system, and inside which you will be running your application. Who will be responsible for this application security?
Microsoft.
Guys, it's inside your VM. You are deciding the operating system. It's your application, right? It's inside the platform. VM is your infrastructure. So who will be managing the platform and that application? It's us, guys. We decide to create our application. Who manages this application, guys? If I create a virtual machine, and inside this virtual machine, if I install anything, if I do anything inside it, who is responsible of this operating system? We manage our operating system, right? We manage it. It's on us, right? If I create a web application inside my VM and I will use it as a server, so we are responsible how to manage it. We will decide what kind of the update that needs to be installed or not. Any update that needs to be discarded or blocked, we will be doing it. So in infrastructure as a service, guys, we need to understand that what are my responsibility areas over here. Guys, see this particular picture, right? Now in this particular picture, you can understand what are the areas and which particular model we need to make sure in terms of the security. So this is your shared responsibility model, guys. If you are on premises, everything will be on customers. But if you are using a infrastructure as a service, Microsoft will manage your physical data center, networking, and your host. Operating system and above will be managed by us. So if you talk about application in infrastructure as a service, we are the one who are managing the application. Clear? Even in platform as a service, it totally depends what kind of the application you are using. If you are using Microsoft created application, at that point of time, Microsoft will be managing the security. Otherwise, if we are the one who will be developing that application, we are totally responsible for the security of that application. Clear? So even though the platform as a service we will be using, we are the one who will be responsible for the application in case we are developing the application. Clear with everyone? Guys, yes, are please. We able to follow? Yeah.
Yes.
So this perimeter level of the security we have already discussed, right? This is your DDoS protection and firewall falls under it. Network layer of the security, that is your NSG, which will be falling under this over here. Now shared responsibility, where you have your on-premises, where everything will be followed by us in terms of your data governance, rights, management, client endpoints, your account access and the management, identity access management, everything will be on us. But in infrastructure, Microsoft will manage our physical and host and network data center security in platform as a service. Till operating system, it will be managed by Microsoft. Apart from that, we just need to check who will be managing what kind of the services, and accordingly, responsibility will be shared. In software as a service, guys, can anyone give me an example of software as a service? And guys, what is the difference between platform as a service and software as a service? Anyone who can help me with this?
Office 365.
Office 365 is what?
Software as a service.
And how it is different from platform as a service? So let's say Office 365 is your software as a service and operating system, let's say Windows 10 is your operating system, right? This is your platform as a service.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
How it is different from one another?
On platform as a service, we can work on the particular platform that had given for given. And as a software as a service, we can develop any software to or some application to.
In software as a service, you can develop any application. Think.
Yeah.
Think. And you are developing an application. Application will be developed on a platform.
No, sir.
Platform as a service, we can create our own software.
In platform as a service, we can work on a particular platform that can be given for us to work.
Mm-hmm.
And in software as a service, we can work on any particular software.
Mm-hmm.
Confusing? Yep.
Actually, you know, Sandeep is Mahinder. In case of PaaS, we as a customer we get a platform and we built an application on top of that. Let's say platform is web app and we built the application, web application there, right? In terms of the SaaS platform, in terms of the SaaS actually, that layer is basically provided by Microsoft, let's say SFDC or 365. Okay, so these are the layers where we are not concerned about. I mean, in PaaS, I was supposed to build a website. I was supposed to build a website because I got a platform, right? But in this case, I'm not supposed to build a website. I'm already getting a website which is O365 or SFDC. So I think that's the difference. Even in SaaS as well, if it is my SFDC, now from there onward, I have to still take care of my identity management, my accounts, as you rightly mentioned in the screen actually.
Okay. See, Narendra, let me tell you one thing. Regarding the identity access management, you need to manage everywhere, whether it's SaaS, PaaS or...
Yes.
Yeah. Infrastructure, right? Because that is
Excuse me, sir.
Software as a services, it is just a complete product that is run and managed by service provider. Just example of Salesforce and SAP, like this.
Correct.
And in case of platform as a services, we don't have to manage underlying services like capacity planning or patching. That, for example, OpenShift.
Mm-hmm.
That is one thing.
Okay.
Sir, in software as a service,
mm-hmm.
we can work on the software which are owned by the client,
mm-hmm.
and in PaaS,
owned by us as well, right?
Owned by its client, them software which are owned by them to its client,
mm-hmm.
and in PaaS. The programming language tools that are provided by the cloud provider. Mm-hmm. We can work on that.
Okay. Okay, guys. Everyone have certain understanding, right? I mean, what is your platform as a service or software as a service? Let me give you a difference, I mean, that makes things clear over here. Guys, whenever you are using platform as a service, how you will be billed? How you will be charged book for? How long you will be using the platform? Yes.
Guys? Till the time we are in need of that particular application.
Sorry, you didn't get that. Can you come again?
We will be using that particular PaaS service till the time we require it. Let's say if it is SQL database or if it's any database or if it's a website actually, a web app. So till the time we need the web app,
We are mixing too many things. SQL database, website, these are again, right? So let's take an example of database. Now, database can be the part of the infrastructure as a service and platform as a service as well.
Yeah.
Right? If you're creating your database on top of a VM, it is an infrastructure as a service. You are responsible for licensing and everything, right? But if you're using a platform as a service database as well, that becomes platform as a service, right? So these are two different things, right? Now, taking an example of an application, web application, right? If I'm the one who is developing my application, Microsoft will be providing a platform to me, right? So I will be charged how long I will be using that platform. Are you getting my point?
Yeah.
It means if I use 24 hours, I will be charged for 24 hours. If I'll be using 8 hours, I'll be charged for 8 hours, right? If my website will be running 12 hours, it will be charged for 12 hours, isn't it?
Absolutely. So
in platform as a service, your pricing will depend how much I will use. But in software as a service, either it will be on the subscription basis, either you will be paying on quarterly basis, half yearly basis, or maybe it's a lifetime license, irrespective how many hours you will be using that software. That's the first difference, right? So in your software as a service, let's say I have purchased my Outlook application, whether I will open my Outlook application, send 1,000 email, or I will send only one email, my pricing will remain as it is. But in platform as a service, if I will consume, my application is heavy, it consuming more compute, more cost will come. If my application is lightweighted, it is consuming less, less cost will come, right? So in platform as a service, it's on the basis of the consumption that how much compute I will be using and how long I will be using that application. And SaaS, SaaS is something which is on the basis of the license. That is the biggest difference. Another difference that you have, that SaaS is something that, you know, your platform is already available. Your environment is already there. You install software inside that particular environment, right? In order to fulfill certain tasks. Now that task can be anyone. Anything, let's say Salesforce, it can be a CRM tool, it can be your Office 365 application, it can be a SAP application, that is your NetWeaver application, or it can be any database related application. Now your software as a service is basically that you have bought that particular software and you have installed to fulfill a particular task. In platform as a service, whatever fulfillment that you will have, you are the one who will be developing that application and you will be running on top of any particular server. Right now, if you will be using a VM, that is your infrastructure as a service. If you are not using a VM, if Microsoft is providing the platform, that is your platform as a service. I hope this is clear, guys, with everyone. Any doubt, any queries over here?
No, sir.
Any questions? Please let me know, guys, if in case you have confusion. So, guys, what happened? So here, what we have, guys, let's take an example over here, okay? Just give me 1 minute, please. There are participants who are still joining. Just give me 1 minute. So guys, how your VM host work? If I talk about a VM host, you have something called infrastructure in between, right? In beneath it. And on top of the infrastructure, we have something called your virtualization. Isn't it? How your VM host work, guys? If I say VM host, right? So your infra is basically is what? Compute, virtual CPU, memory, storage, or network. So compute, storage, and network is your infra, right? And on top of it, what do you have? You have hypervisor, Hyper-V, or if you are using VMware, it is VMware, right? So what do you have on top of it? Virtualization. So what do you have virtualization over here? So your virtualization helps you creating multiple VMs on top of your infrastructure, right? Now, let's give you one example, guys. You purchase your laptop, install Windows 10 or Linux operating system. On top of it, use any virtualization. Right. And if your laptop have 16 GB RAM, create 4 machines of 44 GB RAM. So what you did? You created 4 hardwares on top of the infrastructure that you have in order to use your hardware capacity efficiently, isn't it? Are you getting my point? So guys, anyone who will be using laptop, they are not using their laptop up to the full potential. Do we use our laptop up to this 100% capacity? Yes, no?
No.
Definitely not. Maximum 30, 35 or 40, at max 45%, right? Not 100%. Now, if I create four machines on top of my laptop and assign 4 GB RAM, I have created four machines and I can use these four machines for different purposes as well. Maybe different application will be working inside each other, isn't it? So what I did, I used my hardware up to its full potential, right? But if I'm talk about, if I talk about platform as a service, right? There is a shared operating system. So guys, over here, the operating system, what we have, will my application use all the services of the operating system? If my application is running inside the platform, will it consume all the services? Let's take an example of my machine, guys. I will go to services.msc, right? I would like to see how many services are running over here. So you will see the bunch of services running. Will my application, how many application I'm using? I'm using Zoom, I'm using MS Paint, Teams, and my PowerPoint. So all these services are required for these four applications. Whatever is running over here, bunch of services running, guys, automatically running. I'm not even using them, but they are running over here. Am I using all of them?
No.
Definitely not.
No,
right?
No,
so yes, over here, this particular service has not been used. But guys, try to understand that here, what you did, you uses your hardware efficiently, but not the operating system. In platform as a service, what Microsoft says, you just tell me the requirement of the infrastructure you required. You just tell me what will be the operating system that you required. And you will tell me that what will be the runtime that you required. So if I am a developer, how much things I have to manage before writing a code? I need to purchase a laptop. I need to install the platform. And after that, I will need to install my SDK. That is your software development kit or integrated development environment, like your Visual Studio or JVM or PHP. And after that, I will be able to run my code. Right. So before a developer can be productive, they need to invest money for everything and they will start working after that. So Microsoft says you don't have to invest that much of time and cost. You just tell me your requirement. You tell me what kind of the infrastructure that you need. You tell me what kind of the operating system that you required, whether it will be Linux or Windows. Okay. Right. And I will help you creating your environment. And you can come and you can just directly come with your code and you can execute, right? So what kind of a code you will be running, whether it will be Java code or whether it will be a PHP code, come with that requirement and I will help you to create that particular environment ready. Now your runtime will be ready only with those kind of the services which will be required by your application. So basically, what is your platform as a service? Is this the operating system virtualization? Clear? So this is your hardware virtualization and this is your OS virtualization. So you are using your operating system efficiently. So none of the services is getting waste over here. Clear with everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is, guys, why your platform as a service. So here the platform as a service over here, that application and everything will be depending who will be developing is their responsibility. Microsoft will be managing by the time it's operating system, right? Over here. And in software as a service, identity and directory depends who will be managing, but we are the one who will be running our software. So this access management and client endpoints will be falling under the customer level of the security. And rest is something which is maintained by Microsoft. Clear?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Now proceeding further, guys, why we use identity access management, guys? As I said, for authentication and authorization. What do you mean by authentication? Who can access authorization? What level of the accessibility that you can have, right? So identifies the person or a service seeking access to the resource, request legitimate access credential and basis of your creating secure identity and access control principle. And guys, this is not only for the users. This is for your applications as well. Let's say I need to develop a web application which required an accessibility to the database, right? Now, let's say this is my web application in the backend. This required an accessibility to the database, for an example, right? Now, if your application want an accessibility to the database, two kind of a things that can happen. Either you can give a connection string inside your web application code so that your web application can access your database, right? So with the help of API, somebody will be able to put certain information and that will be injected in the database. That is one way. Mm-hmm. Another way, guys, if you don't want any kind of a hack through API level, because somebody who will be hacking the code, they will be able to get the information of the connection string. What you do, you create your key vault where you create your secure information. And in spite of providing the accessibility to that web application, you provide the accessibility from the key vault section. And that is something, this is something which is managed over here, right? So what level of the accessibility and how accessibility will be provided, you will be deciding with the help of your authentication and authorization, right? So you will decide what kind of a role will be assigned to a user or to a service or to a resource. Clear with everyone?
Yes.
Yep. Now, apart from that, your Azure Active Directory, like your Microsoft Cloud-based Identity Access Management. So guys, your authentication. So for the, guys, what is single sign-on, first of all? Anyone? Guys, what is single sign-on?
You sign in with one account and then use the account for all other services.
So basically what you're trying to do with single sign-on, you're trying to mitigate the dependency on multiple username and the password, right? If there is an organization and one person need to access 10 application, so a user not need to remember 10 users name and the 10 password for 10 different application. This is not only the problem from the user end, but also it will create problem for your entire admin department, that for single user, if there will be 10 username and the password, and let's say there are 1,000 employees, how many credentials you need to manage for different person? 10,000 credential, it will be a problem, right? So to avoid such kind of a challenges, what they do, they create one username and the password with the help of your Azure Active Directory, and they will ensure that that secure login will be managed for all different applications. Clear? So your single sign-on, single username and the password for multiple application, which will be integrated with your Azure Active Directory, right? Now further, for your application management, where your B2B and your B2C identity services comes into the picture. So guys, what is B2B? Business to business. What is business to business, guys? Anyone? Guys, what is
within business? The same organization, actually, like for my organization, to my organization identity management, or B2C is like me and with my customers. Like if my I'm running an internal e-commerce website and I'm going to manage the identities of my customers, right? So that is basically business to customers.
Okay. So let me ask this question. I mean, as you said, B2B is within the organization. Can I not send an invitation or invite anyone from the other organization for B2B?
It's a different. B2B is a business to business. For example, a manufacturing company is, you know, creating a boilers. Mm-hmm. That boilers will not be given to a consumer, end user. Those will be mm-hmm. given to some industry, pharma industry, mm-hmm. or maybe food processing industry.
So it can be outside the organization for another organization as well, right?
Right. And B2C will more be consumer, end users will be there, business to consumers.
So guys, always remember, yeah, correct. So guys, over here, always remember, when you are dealing with B2B, right? B2B is, let's say this is your directory, right? You have created your users over here, right? And let's say what users are managing over here, let's say whatever resources you have created, let's say your database, right? And out of your resources, any user is managing your database, any user is managing your VM, any user is managing any resources which is in your directory, right? So B2B basically is what? Inviting other users in your directory. Either you will be creating their username and the password and they will be accessing the username with the help of that credential that you will be providing, or either you will be inviting those users in your directory so that whatever task that needs to be fulfilled over here, that will be able to fulfill over here as well. Like, for example, I need to develop a website. Now, I don't have developers. So what I will do, I will hire some team of freelancers. Now, if I'm hiring somebody as a freelancers, either I can invite them in my directory or I will give them some username and the password through which they will log in. So this is what? This is B2B. Are you getting my point? Why? Because they are managing my source and application by the becoming a part of my directory over here, right? Or either I will allow them to use my resources for their business purpose. So this is your B2B, guys. Now, what is B2C? Let's say I have created a website. These users have created this website and they are doing maintenance and the development over here. But a customer who will be using this website as a consumer will be the part of another directory where you are managing all your customer, and that relationship, we call it B2C. Clear with everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is how you manage your B2B and this is how you manage your B2C. A layman example, guys, whomsoever is working on Facebook, they must have an email ID that abc@facebook.com. But being a user, being a consumer, we are free to use any email address in order to log in and register to that particular website. And we can access Facebook or any particular Twitter, Instagram, whatever. We can have a social media website. So we are, you know, accessing that application as a customer, but somebody who will be working on the development side and from the back end, they will be the part of B2B if they are interacting among the different directories or the tenants. Okay. Clear with everyone? Now that can be in the same organization or different organization. That is B2B. Clear? All good with everyone? So here, guys, this is one of the example that you have for B2B and B2C over here. Now, Azure multi-factor authentication. So guys, multi-factor authentication, we are using from last 8 to 10 years, right? People who are using banking apps, you guys are pretty much familiar how your multi-factor authentication works, right? Your OTP, your one-time passwords, these are all example of your multi-factor authentications, right? So multi-factor authentication is nothing, it's an additional layer of the security, which ensured that the username and the password used by a person, and that person is a legitimate person. For example, let's say if I have seen somebody's username and the password, I can also log in and I can also access the same thing. But what I don't have multi-factor authentication accessibilities. For example, even though I will be able to type there a person username and the password, but after that it will require additional layer of the security, maybe an OTP code, and maybe that code will be sent to your mobile phone or maybe to another email address, right? So something that you know, what we know, maybe the security questions, something that you possess, your mobile or any particular email account accessibility, and something that you are, maybe on the basis of biometric, or maybe you are a manager and you will be receiving the OTP on your reportee's behalf. So something that you know, something that you possess, and something that you are, right? So provide additional security for your identity to require two or more elements for full authentication. And these elements fail three categories, something that you know, something that you possess, and something that you are. Clear with everybody? All good? Guys, are we able to follow?
Yes. Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
After that, guys, we have Azure Security Center. Now, guys, Azure Security Center is nothing. It's a service which actually help you providing the recommendations from the Microsoft Azure side that whatever resources that you are creating on Azure, whether those resources required any additional security, or maybe as a human, I have created a security, but I have left some loopholes. So Microsoft will provide the recommendation as per the best security practices. The only thing that you need to make sure that your security center is enabled in your subscription so that you will start getting the recommendations. How it is looks like, guys, see, I have created a virtual machine over here. If I go ahead and type, just give me 1 minute. Just give me 1 minute, guys. Okay, guys, coming back. So I was talking about security center that you can get a recommendation. Now, what kind of a recommendation I'm talking about, guys? I'm going into the security center, guys. I'll just show you. This is your security center, guys. So if I go to security center, I have created one particular virtual machine over here, right? We do have a recommendation options, and you can see the list of recommendations which are giving over here, right? Related to the resources I have created a few minutes ago. See all these red marks. It means that I have to take action on this. See, if you like to see the recommendation, click over here. External permission, right? Unhealthy resources over here. So all these kind of the permissions, guys, that you can see over here. Enable multi-factor authentication, see? MFA should be enabled on the account, right? These are the recommendations. This is how the recommendations are coming from the Microsoft Azure side. And the recommendation you will be able to fulfill, better security you will be able to create. So these are the recommendation, guys, not only from Active Directory, but from your endpoint protection, from your monitoring protection, from your encryption data protection, guys, Everything is available over here. And on the basis of this recommendation, it's up to you whether you would like to follow the recommendations or not. But this definitely helps you in order to manage your resources efficiently, guys. Not only that, guys, you can also see the recommendations from the regulatory compliance side that you will be able to see it over here. You can download a report on the basis of what you required on the PCI or ISO or SOC compliant reports on the basis of that as well. And you can see whether your resources are compliant or not. So these are also one of the recommendations, guys, that you will be able to see. PCI, ISO, SOC over here. And any particular policy that you would like to manage by yourself as well, the choices are available. You can download the report from here and you will be able to see the compliance related information as well. See, the reports are available depending how many resources are compliant or how many resources are not. So you can conduct your audits as well on the basis of it. So this is how your security center actually help you managing your resources. Clear with everyone? So provide security recommendation based on your configuration and the resources and network, and monitors your security setting across your on-premises and your cloud workload as well. So choices are available, guys. You can not only monitor your your cloud resources, but also your on-premises resources using your security center, guys. So you do have a choice available in order to manage such kind of the resources. So if you like to manage such kind of the resources from here, you can go to the security solutions. And choices are available for your non-Azure resources. Now, guys, non-Azure resources, not only on-premises, guys, but also the resources which you have created in AWS and your GCP. That is your Amazon Web Services or Google Cloud Platform as well. You can also integrate them as well here. And then you can also see the recommendations related to those resources. So it's a pretty powerful tool, guys, you can see, which can help you providing the recommendation and automatically applies your security policies to any new services that we have already seen that you can have. So what your security center does, it assesses, it detects the problem, right? And what it do, it after that diagnose the problem, it stabilize the situation, and then it will close the incident. So this is how it will be able to provide your recommendation. Assess, detect, provide you the recommendation, diagnose, stabilize, and close it. This is how your security center uses scenario. This is how one's supposed to use the security center recommendations. Keyword, guys, keyword help you protecting your security information, like your keys, certificate, your HSMs, that is your hardware security module, right? So your secrets can be your connection string through which one resource is accessing another, like your tokens through which you access application. And keys can be your disk encryption keys, your RSA or your cryptographic keys that you can have. Your certificates can be your digital sign certificate, like you're signed by your certificate authority, like your DigiCert or your global sign. And HSMs are your hardware security modules that can be used on the on-premises side. Clear with everyone? Guys, any doubt, any queries? Do let me know. Guys, are we able to follow so far?
Clear, Sandeep.
Okay. Now, apart from that, guys, there are Azure information protection options available. So Microsoft is pretty transparent in order to, you know, help you that you can create any kind of the levels related to the resources, what are critical for you, right? So some guidance and the recommendations are available for that. Azure Advanced Threat Protection. So depending on that threat, guys, sensors are available, which keep on, you know, providing you the detections related alert associated with it, right? So you are keep on getting the, you know, such kind of the assessment reports, and you can getting the alerts from the Microsoft side as well, in case if you'll have. There are Azure governance policies are available in order to manage it, right? So not only that, guys, that there are policies which are created by Microsoft, you can also create your own policies as well. So stay compliant with your corporate standard and your service level agreement by using your policy and the definition, which can help you enforcing your effects of your Azure resources, right? So guys, why we create policy? We create policy to create a standard, right? So that your resources can be compliant in your production environment, right? So for that particular purpose, Microsoft has given initiative, you know, multiple capabilities available, right? So your policies, you create a standard, and we also have initiative definitions. So initiatives are nothing, guys. These are group of policies. So if you want to enable multiple policies in one go, you can group them together and you will be able to implement them as well, right? So you do have an option available to create initiative where you will be able to club your policies together. I'll just show you over here, guys. Let's say I have created a VM. right? And over here inside VM, guys, you will get an option available to implement any sort of policies. So let's take an example. Apart from your identity access management over here, guys, just give me 1 minute. Excuse me, guys. So coming back, so guys, we were talking about the policies. So here, in terms of the policies, guys, you can see we do have an option available for the policies at any level. So you can implement policy to your resources, to your resource group, to your subscription, where you would like to create a standard over here. So if I go to policies over here, guys, you will be able to see there are multiple policies which are available that can be assigned. And accordingly, you will be able to see the compliant report associated with that. So you do have an option available that you can assign policies and you can exclude your resources associated with it over here. So you can decide your scope related to that. And there are 494 policies that Microsoft has already created that you can use. Now currently showing 499. So guys, these policies are keep on that Microsoft updating over here. So guys, yesterday it was 494. And within one or I would say 24 hours, there are five more policies which has been introduced. So guys, it will not be surprised that if tomorrow you will see more than 500 over here. Right. So over the span of last 6 months, it has been increased from 434 to 499. And there will be more policies which will be coming in upcoming days as well. So this is something either you can directly assign. Now, guys, you do have an option available for initiative, which are nothing. These are group of policies that you will have. So, guys, there are approximately 29 initiatives which are available. And you can see now currently this is 26 guys over here. So how we can see this particular initiatives over here? So guys, for that, you can directly assign a group of policies over here. If one need to see that what will be the definition on those policies, what exactly those policies are carrying inside it. For that, you can go into the resource group section and you can go into the policies over here and you will be see exact definition that which particular policy has been created for what particular purpose over here. So over here, guys, these are certain called initiative. These are nothing. These are group of policies. So if you like to see, let's say this is one of the policy which has been created by grouping 77 policy. So definition type is initiative. So initiative is nothing. This is group of policies. So 77 policies have been merged together. You can click over here and you can see what are the policies which are following this particular initiative over here. This is something that you can see. In the same fashion, guys, if there are policies available, 790 policies has been merged together. See? So depending on your requirement, guys, if you want to assign a group policy together, the assignment can be done. And these are some of the choices available that you can do in terms of the assignment of the resources over here. So evaluate and identify your Azure resources that do not comply with your policies. Provides built-in policy and initiative definition under categories such as storage, networking, compute, and security center and monitoring. So choices are available, guys. Policies and their definitions. So allowed storage size, kind of a policy that condition and the rule defined acceptable sizes and new storage account. Request to create a storage account outside the defined sizes. So maybe on the basis of the size as well, you can create policy or maybe on the basis of the location as well, right? So this is how you can define the definition on the basis of the location as well. And you can create your policies, guys. Clear? Any questions? Questions, guys?
Yes, sir. Can we store more than 1800 policy or multiple policy at a time?
So you're talking about if in case you need to group policies together, will you be able to group more than 100 policies together in one particular initiative. This is what you are looking for?
Yep.
Yes, we can.
Okay, sir.
As we have just seen, 790 policies were merged together. Or, so that is something. Yeah, yeah.
Also, we can store a single policy or...
Yeah, you can also create a standalone policy. Both choices are available. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
See, if you need to, add any custom policies. So first of all, you need to create a standalone policy. Only then you will be able to group them, right? So if you need to create a custom policy, so definitely the things will be starting with a granular, a standalone policy. And later on, you will be able to club them until and unless these are built-in policy you would like to merge together. Yeah?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Suppose one group of policy, then you want to change another group of policy after few days you means you need other policy. So how exactly you will do in
See, the way you are assigning a policy, right? Tomorrow, if you don't want to assign any particular policy, you can remove it as well, right? Now, let's take an example. Let's say you have created a resource group, right? And you created a dependency that nobody will be able to create any resources outside the country, right? You created a location-based policy. Now, tomorrow, as the situation changes, now you're, you know, you want to allow the resources to create any resource outside that particular location in the same resource group. So changes in the policy can be done any given point of time, right? So either you will be removing that particular policy from the group or adding more policies, and then you will be assigning, or you can also assign a separate policy as well in order to make those kind of the changes. So depending what is feasible, you can do any kind of change.
Okay.
Yeah, because this is the assignment, right? So if you're assigning something, you can assign another thing which can override, or you can remove the previous one. Yeah.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. Okay. Any further questions, guys? Okay, guys. So apart from that, guys, as we talk about initiative, group multiple policies definition into a single unit to track compliance at a greater and macro level. So definitely, if you like to manage things at macro level, go with initiative. Initiative assignments are assigned to a specific scope. So maybe if you want to assign a initiative to a resource, that is also fine, or you can assign at a resource group level, or you can also assign group of policies to a subscription level as well. So whatever resources you will be creating inside the subscription will fall under that particular scope category. Role-based access control, guys, this is pretty much familiar with that, any role that you can assign, owner, contributor, and reader. And this is something that you can see over here. So let's say I'm going to this particular VM, and over here as well, I can assign any particular role from here for the identity access management. You can do that. So as I said, the rules can be assigned to a user or group of user or to service principals or to any particular resource as well. So you can assign any particular role, guys, owner, contributor, or reader. And if you don't want to assign any particular built-in role, you can create our own roles as well. So choices are available for that. Let's say contributor role, you can assign to any particular resource as well or to any particular user as well, which is the part of your Azure Active Directory over here. Clear? You can save it over here. So this is how you will be able to manage your role-based access control. So what do you mean by your role-based access control? Fine-grained access management control over your Azure resources and able to available to all Azure subscriber at no additional cost, guys. So grant access right to a particular user for the certain job, or one user can manage VMs with while another managing virtual network. So for the separation of the assignment, that who will be managing what for that particular purpose, guys. Guys, locks. So there are certain locks available, guys, that you can use. And definitely you have this choice available to avoid any kind of the accidental deletion. So any of the locks that you will be creating at resource group level or at resource level, up to you. Let's say I'm creating a my lock situation over here, and I'm creating a delete lock. So let's say somebody would like to delete any particular resource. If you are not available in the office environment, straight away you will be getting an error message that this resource has been locked. So to avoid any accidental deletion. But guys, it is not a solution to avoid any permanent deletion. Why? Because somebody who will have the owner access at a resource group level where you have created lock can remove lock and also delete the resource as well. So only for avoiding any kind of the accidental delete over here. As you can see, this is the lock available. So I can probably delete the lock, and then I can probably initiate the deletion of the resources as well. Right? So this is not a option to avoid any permanent delete, but choices are available, guys, how you would like to do that. So you can create your cannot delete lock or read only lock depending on your requirement. Azure Advisor, as we have already discussed, guys, that you will be getting recommendation from the Microsoft side. So we have Azure Advisor available, guys, that help you providing the recommendation on the basis of five things: on the basis of performance, on the basis of cost, security, reliability, and operational excellence. So cost recommendation, you can see if in case there is any resource which is not being used, you can download such kind of the recommendations. Currently, there is no such resource like this. Security recommendation, you have already seen, guys, these recommendations are coming from Security Center, guys. So you can click over here and you will be able to see all the recommendation which is coming from your Security Center side. So a few minutes ago, we went into the security center to see the recommendations. And apart from that, you will have your reliability, that is your high availability recommendations, guys. And you can click over here and you can certainly see what all the things that Microsoft has considered before providing you the recommendations. So these are some of the considerations from the Microsoft side. So guys, these recommendations are very important, which actually help you in order to manage your day-to-day and entire resources management that you will be doing from the Azure side. And this recommendation, guys, you will be able to download in the PDF format, and you will be able to see that what kind of the recommendation that Azure will be providing to you. So you can open these recommendations. Currently, we could not find any recommendation. Otherwise, there will be a recommendation report, just like a few minutes ago that you have seen your PCI compliant report accordingly. So similarly, guys, you will be able to see all these recommendations over here from the Azure Advisor. Blueprints, guys. Now, guys, blueprints are nothing. It actually helping you in order to create resources. Now, guys, what are the ways that you can create resources in Azure? Anyone? How we create resources, guys, in Azure? Either we deploy our resources using the portal, or we create using the PowerShell, or we use using the CLI, or we use it templates over here, right? These are the ways through which you create resources.
Create resources through Terraform also.
See, Terraform is for the automation, right? So for Terraform, there are other, tools are available like your Chef, Puppet that you can use, or, you can use your automation account, right? So Terraform usually used by the organization who are not only dealing with Azure, they are also dealing with AWS and GCP. So they required a common platform for the automation that they will be able to create their resources on any client with the help of those kind of a tools. So that's where your Terraform comes into the picture.
Okay.
Clear?
Yeah.
Okay. So guys,
in case of production environment, is it really feasible to create your VPC, all these things through Azure portal?
Yes, you can. See, the thing is, let's say if you have a specific requirement, right? Not everybody is the developer in the production, right? Now, for an example, if you have a substantial dependency on the automation, so definitely those guys knows how to create resources through code, right? But let's take an example of your infrastructure team, where they are managing your network, they are ensuring the security, right? So not necessarily that all will be the programmers, right? And in order to manage your network, right, over here it's VNet, VPC will be in your AWS, right? So if they are managing the network, if they need to create additional network in order to manage the security or implement the firewall, definitely they will be using the portal.
Okay.
Yeah.
So why I'm asking, because it is error or something happened, or it is not perfectly done on the VPC one. So might be later it will be a problem when the application will run.
Nandini, what happened over here, that let's say whenever you are creating any resource, right? Now, why you do automation and why you use templates or any script to avoid any repetitive task, right? Because while doing the repetition, you don't want any human error, right? So that's where your templates comes into the picture. But let's say before this template was created, somebody must have created that resource for the first time through portal, and after that taken the template out, right? So any requirement that you are working on, which you are not sure whether this will going to work, or maybe I need to make any sort of changes, right? At that point of time, people usually avoid using code. Once they know that this is a specific pattern and this is kind of a thing that is required, then your, codes comes into the picture. But yes, I mean, changes can be done from the, templates as well, or any particular script as well. But portal is something which is a graphical user interface that you will be getting. And people who are not familiar with PowerShell or CLI or using automation, let's say your PowerShell runbook or Python 2 or Python 3 or graphical script, definitely they will go for portal. Clear?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, guys. So Azure Blueprints. So guys, Azure Blueprints are nothing. These are templates. However, these templates also have a capability that you can assign any particular policy or any particular role-based access control through template as well. So your blueprints are combination of your policy, role-based access control, and templates. So while deploying templates, you will be able to assign any roles and policies using your blueprint as well. Clear? So create reusable environment definition that can be recreated your Azure resources and apply your policies instantly. So guys, after creating the resources, one can assign policy manually. But during the resources getting created through your JSON template, your blueprints can use any kind of the assignment or any kind of the policies as well. So here, if I go into the portal side and if I type blueprint, I do have an option available that I can use blueprints over here, and any kind of the definition assignment that is there, I can create a blueprint. One I have already created, guys, if you can see over here, the moment you can create, see what I did. I assigned a particular security setting policy as well for auditing machine. And with that, I have created my resources in the form of the template as well. If tomorrow I need to create any resource, I can directly assign this particular blueprint. Or if you want to create one, for that, you just need to click on get started and you can click on create. And what you will find creating the blueprint that you can use any templates over here. So if I click on, let's say, a basic networking template that I already have, you can certainly see that I will be selecting that. Let's say I would like to create this blueprint in my subscription and I can give a name, let's say test blueprint. And providing the name, guys, this is the artifacts, and let's see what we can have over here. So we can have our Azure Resource Manager templates and role assignment and your policy assignments. So we do have a choice available for templates as well as role as the policy. And guys, you can select your policy initiative over here that can be managed. And also it can be managed using your role-based access control, owner, contributor, and a reader. So everything can be implemented over here, guys. Clear with that, everyone? Guys, are we able to follow? Everyone?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So this is something, guys, that you can use in your Azure blueprint as well. Proceeding further, guys, your governance, like your subscription governance, like your billing limit and your subscription limit, guys. So these kind of limits that can be, you know, put on your subscription. So just in case, if you want to avoid any excessive usage over here. So guys, let's say I have a subscription. So this is a brand new subscription. I have not used much. So there will not be any particular information related to the billing. So I'm just going into the subscription, which I use excessively. So you will be able to see the billing related report associating with that. So those kind of the information can be also there, which can help you in terms of providing your billing information. So I can go into all services over here. If in case, if you just need to go for your subscription information, you can just type subscription. Your subscription will be available. Click over here in the subscription and you can see how much you have consumed. So you can click over here. So this is one of my MSDN subscription. I can go to the cost analysis option over here and you can see that I can see my subscription limitation, how much I have consumed, how much I will be consuming in upcoming days. All such kind of the information will be available. So this actually help you track your resources down, that how long you will be using those resources and how much which particular resource will be consuming. So not from the size, you know, that how resources will be managed, but also you would like to see that how much you have consumed. So from January 2nd till today, I have consumed 2,823 INR. Now, let's say if I need to see in upcoming days, how much I will be consuming. So this is, I can select from here, my daily cost analysis over here, how much I'm consuming on daily basis, that report is available. So on 2nd of January, I have consumed highest around over here, let's say 78. And accordingly, you know, it is, I have consumed over here. So I have consumed 123 over here. Or let's say if I need to create a forecast report over here, I would like to do a custom range report associated with it. And let's say I would like to do a forecast. So from 1st of August till 31st of this year, how much I will be consuming. So you can certainly see the report associated with it. And this is my forecast, guys. So this is what they say, that I should be ready with 27,507, depending on the usage that I am consuming from August till today. So for Feb and March, they are anticipating that I will end up creating more resources depending on the previous trend I have. Clear? So what they are saying over here, that billing reports you can create. Not only that, you can put a limitation on the subscription as well. So if you put a limitation, definitely you don't want me to consume more than that. So you can have a capping that you can create, and access control. So role-based access control as well, you will be able to assign in your subscription level as well. So you can see I have a identity access management over here. So I'm at a subscription level, guys, here as well, that you can see all the roles are available. Assignment can be done from here as well, guys. So you can assign levels. If you need to create any budget over here, so you do have a choice available, guys, that you will be able to manage your budgeting as well, right? So that option is also available. Taking a while, guys. See, assignment options are available. All the roles are there. Any role that you can assign over here, choices are available. Another thing, you can go to the budget. You can do the capping as well. And not only that particular part, guys, by putting a subscription limit on a particular subscription, what you can do? Apart from creating a budget from a month cycle over here or for a quarter, you can also help creating your access control and billing reports as well. So guys, billing reports you have already seen. If you want to download any particular report, you can just download over here. Or if you want to see the cost by resource, that which particular resource is consuming how much, that is something that you can also do from here itself. So choices are available, guys, how you would like to use them accordingly. It's up to you. Cost by resource, granular management of the resources, guys. Clear? So apart from your governance over here, you can manage your subscription. Now, monitorings are also available, guys. Tags are there. So guys, tags we actually use to categorize any resource, because in the production, there will be 100 of resources will be there. So any particular resource that you have created and you would like to create a tag, right? So your choices are available, guys. So tags are nothing, guys, that actually help you tagging your resources or for creating a nomenclature. Let's say I have created my virtual machine. Let's say if I want to tag this particular virtual machine for IT and operation department. So this is for your categorization and for consolidation purpose, guys. So you can apply tag to your Azure resource providing metadata and logically organize them into a taxonomy such as your organization structured workload, geography, or any other logical grouping over here. So this is something, guys, that is used for, let's say any VM I have created. Let's say I have created a name for a department IT, right? Or maybe tomorrow I need to put a filter on the basis of billing and I will be able to identify my resource. And accordingly, guys, you will have your Azure Monitor. So Azure Monitor helps you generating your activity record, your metrics, any particular data related to the monitoring, guys. So if you can recall, guys, a few minutes ago, I have created a VM over here, right? So any particular monitoring information that you required, you can click on the Azure Monitor over here. You do have an option available, right? So you can see your activity report, any alert that you would like to create on the basis of the activity which has been taken place so far, right? So this actually helps you see all the activities which has been taken place. You can create your alerts on the basis of that as well, right? And what is the job of the alert, guys? Your alerts help you creating the rules over here. So these are the choices available that you can have over here. On the basis of any metric, guys, any particular resource which is running right now, you can certainly see all those matrices depending on the scope that you have over here, right? So choices are available, guys, depending what particular resource that you will be targeting accordingly, you will be able to target your custom metrics. Currently, we don't have any resource, guys. I have deleted my VM, and that is the reason this custom metric usage is coming into the picture over here. But yes, if you will be creating your resources, definitely you will be able to see the metrics associated with that as well in terms of the monitoring, like your CPU utilization report. Right? So this is something that we can have over here, right? So let's say, let me recreate my resource for a while. So just in case, if you like to see that how the monitoring works over here. So let me recreate a version over here. Let's say Windows Server 2016 that I have selected, and this is something that I can do over here. Let's say VM. And if you'd like to see monitoring data, the data will also be available, guys. So not only monitoring at a subscription level, guys, monitoring can be done at any resource level as well, depending what kind of the matrices that you will be using, also on the basis of the activities. And if you like, you can create alert rule on the basis of that as well. So let's suppose I'm creating this particular machine. Your machine will also have a monitoring capability, so that we will see in a few minutes. And I have initiated over here. So guys, what all things? Activity, metrics. On the basis of that, you will be able to perform evaluation. Your health alerts. So guys, health alerts are fine. These are also important. If any of the resources which are not healthy, right, definitely they are not capable of handling any kind of the workload. So definitely, guys, it is very important to keep your resources healthy or any of the resources down. Definitely, you will not be assigning a task. I'll give you one example, guys. For an example, let's say you are using a server behind your load balancer. Let's say this is your load balancer. And these machines are used in behind of the load balancer. Let's say a load is hitting to your load balancer and it is getting distributed among to your backend server. So guys, let's say if any of the machine is not in a shape of handling the load, what will happen if you keep on directing the load to that particular machine? If they are not in a position to handle the load. Quickly, guys, what will happen?
Machine will be hang or stop working.
Machine is anyways, guys, is not healthy, right? Why we create a load balancer? So that we will be able to handle our load efficiently, right? And if we are routing the traffic to a machine which is unhealthy, definitely the load will not be able to handle by that machine. So the entire effort failed over here, right? You wanted to handle the load with the help of the server, but you routed a machine to a particular, you routed the load to a machine which is not healthy. It means you are assigning a work to an employee which is not willing to work, or maybe that employee is not healthy. So anyways, that person will not be able to fulfill the job. So in the same manner, guys, if your resources are down, there is no point assigning any particular task to such kind of the resources. And that is the reason your health check of the resources is fine. So guys, if this load balancer will be able to do a health check, and if they know already that this machine is down, it will start routing the traffic only to that machine which is healthy in nature. Right. So if I know a particular machine is already down and not healthy, definitely I will route the traffic to my healthy nodes. So automatically my traffic management will be efficiently handled. Right. So in the same fashion, guys, your health alerts and health monitoring are very important in terms of your resource handling, so that you will be able to route your traffic, or you will be able to manage your resources efficiently. Right. So Azure Status helps you providing your health related information. Azure helps customizing your dashboard alert and start of your services in the region that you use, and diagnose and obtain support for your Azure services and issues affecting your resources, right? So if you will be able to monitor the health, it is very important, so that what kind of action that we need to take, probably I will be ready in order to take such kind of the actions. Clear with everyone? Guys, are we able to follow so far?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So guys, how monitoring function, basically with the help of the data, whatever you have, whether it's a metric data, activity data, you analyze certain information, right? Now, maybe there is an alert. So how you analyze that particular data on the basis of the data? So maybe that alert on the basis of an activity, let's say machine shut down abruptly. I would like to get a notification. So I have created an alert for that, right? So what I did, I analyzed the situation, and according to the alert, right, what I do, I respond. So why I create alerts? So that I can respond to that situation, what I have analyzed. So what I have analyzed is my condition, that I have an insight. How I'm responding is on the basis of the alert, so that I would like to handle the situation, right? Visualize. After handling the situation, I would like to see the trend, how often this kind of a problem is happening, right? And integrate. I will automate the task so that next time I don't have to take the action, it is automatically taken care of. Clear? Analyzing, knowing what needs to be done, responding, getting aware of what has happened, visualizing how often things are happening, and integrating to ensure that this kind of a thing can be taken care automatically. Clear with everyone?
Guys, sir, can you please repeat this? I can't understand.
No problem. Analyzing, right? Now, what do you analyze? So guys, whenever you are doing monitoring, what you will do? You will collect logs, like your activity log, right? Or let's say any particular metric log, right? Now, what you do with this kind of a data? You try to analyze the situation, right? And on the basis of that, what you do? You create alert. Let's say if your machine shut down frequently, what you do? You create alert that next time if this happened, it should send an alert at that point of time, right?
Yes, sir.
Let me show you. Now, let's say if this particular machine is there, for an example, this machine is there, right? What I want to analyze that particular information, how I can get into the logs and I can see that how this particular machine is available. So maybe I would like to analyze that particular information, right? So I can enable this, right? And after that, what? I would like to see visibility into the health and performance of your virtual machine. So it will actually help you analyzing your information. Then what you do? You create alert. Why you create alert? So that whenever such kind of a thing happen, you will be alerted on the basis of it, right? Now, let's take an example. Let my machine getting shut down. Or let's say if on the matrix or on the basis of activity, let's consider an activity. Let's say my power of virtual machine, right? So let's say this is happening frequently. So I have created an alert. Now with the help of alert, I would like to be notified, right? So what I can do, I can create an action group that whenever this kind of a thing happen, I will receive a notification over an email. Now, if I know how frequently this particular information, this kind of a event is happening, right? I can give my email address or I can give my phone number as well over here. That whenever this kind of a thing is happening, I would like to send an email notification. And not only that, I would like to take an action. So once I know how frequently it is happening, I can also use my automation. I can use my function app, logic app in order to fix such kind of a problem as well. So this is what I was referring. That first you analyze the situation, then you respond on the basis of the alert, and then you visualize. So guys, you have analytical tools available to visualize the report, like your Power BI dashboard, charts and tables. On the basis of that, what you do? You see the previous trend, how often it is happening, right? So even in your production environment, what happened? If any kind of a problem happened, they will try to fix the problem and they will go back and check how often this kind of a problem is happening. And what they do? They try to visualize this information and they try to integrate with some mechanism so it will be fixed. Another example, let's say a particular error keep on happening. What you do? You create alert. Now with the alert, you create a mechanism that next time it will happen, it will automatically trigger a ticket, or with the help of ServiceNow or any ITSM mechanism, a ticket will be created and assigned to an available representative. Now, how many tickets came? What you do? You visualize the data and you realize that how often this kind of a problem happen. If problem is happening very frequently, so rather creating a ticket, you will create a code or any particular script to fix the problem, rather creating a code, and every time a human will be fixing the situation. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So this is how, guys, you will analyze, respond, visualize, and integrate on the basis of that, right? And guys, on the basis of that, you will have multiple privacy. Guys, these are the organizations. Now, what are these organizations like? CJIS, so compliance terms and requirement. So guys, like Azure, there are other providers as well, like AWS, GCP, Alibaba, IBM. So these are also cloud solution provider. Now, who will take care that these solution provider, whatever they are doing, these are 100% compliant. So guys, for that particular purpose, there are certain authorities which are available, like CJIS, that is your criminal justice information, health insurance portability accountability act, CSA star certification, ISO, your GDPR for European general data protection and regulation, NIST, that is your National Institute of Standards and Technology. So guys, every organization or every client have their requirement that what kind of environment they want and what kind of a compliance policy they would like to follow, right? And accordingly, you will have all these available. So as you can see, guys, we just downloaded ISO related compliance report when we were in the security center. So these organization will help you to manage your compliance, and Microsoft are pretty much compliant with all these organizations, right? So Microsoft has already taken care of your compliance. If you take an example of your on-premises, you are the one who will be taking care of all this compliance and everything. But on cloud, Microsoft has already taken these kind of the responsibilities and they are managing it. Microsoft privacy statement. So like your data, Microsoft processing, how Microsoft is processing it and for what purpose. So Microsoft is pretty transparent, guys. This is the URL, guys, microsoft.com/privacy-statement. You can click on this particular URL and there will be a document which will be opened over here. And Microsoft has mentioned clearly that what kind of a data they will be capturing and for what purpose they will be capturing. So Microsoft is pretty transparent. So if you're from the compliance team, if you like to get into such kind of the reports, choices are available, guys. These are pretty transparent information that you can have. Clear? Apart from that, there is a trust center, guys. So this is learning about your security, privacy, compliance policy feature and practices across Microsoft. So Trust Center website provides in-depth expert information, curated list of your recommended resources, arranged by topic and role specified information and business managers and administrative risk assessors. So guys, in every organization, we have a department who will be evaluating all the policies, what will be the risk, if they will be integrating it. So guys, this particular URL, that is your trust center, provides all these kind of the information related to the privacy, that why Microsoft is using it and what level of the accessibility will be there. So this is just to get a trust from the client sides. So the Microsoft is pretty much transparent for such kind of the data as well, guys. Same goes with your servicetrust.microsoft.com, guys. You can go and see that what kind of the audits that Microsoft can does and how the Microsoft will be compliant for your audit reports, for your cloud services and your publications about your trust and how Microsoft Cloud Services protects your data. So guys, what level of the security that Microsoft will be providing, this is something that you can see with the help of these, and you will be able to see over here as well. Clear, guys? So over here, this is the document, guys, that you can have, like servicetrust.microsoft.com. Just click on this particular URL, guys. Over here, you will be able to see all the documents where Microsoft has provided this information, that what kind of the audit reports that can be generated, SOC, FedRAMP, ISO, PCI, and there are many more, guys. Right? These are the audits that can be done, and Microsoft is already compliant using those kind of the audits, guys. Apart from that, there is a compliance manager which will assign, track, and verify everything, whether the every activity inside Azure, whether they are compliant or not, and is keep on managing their risk assessment with the help of your risk assessment tool over here in the trust portal. And you can see that you can have any compliance and you can continuously evaluate it as well. So maybe the things are compliant right now, but what will happen after 5 days, 10 days, right? Whether your policies are efficient enough to handle the compliance or not. So those kind of the evaluations are also happening in terms of these kind of the compliance. So storing your manager, your compliance and effects over here. And guys, there are certain, government services which are involved over here. So guys, Azure not only provide any kind of the services to only customers, guys, they also provide services to government authorities like your DoD, that is your Department of Defense for United States, and also, guys, many private clouds for China and for Germany as well. Though the political relationship between US and China and Germany are not that good, still Microsoft provides the services to those kind of countries as well, where they are using their own data center. And guys, your Azure is 100% compliant, right? So what did that means, guys, over here? It means, guys, in such kind of the authorities, which are, very secure, they are also trusting Azure for such kind of the requirement over here, right? So guys, you can understand certainly that this is something that which is very secure over here and meets the security and compliance needs for US federal agencies, state, local states, and their solution providers as well. So your separate instances for Azure, physical isolation for your US government authorities over here, right? So all these, as you can see, these are compliant from multiple authorities over here. So these are secure. Your Germany services, guys. So in Germany, there are other third-party organization who take care of their data centers over here and which will be totally compliant by their regulatory commissions over here. So guys, these are pretty much secure, guys. Your customer data support services reside in German data center, and data centers are managed by independent German data trustee, and data replication confined to German data centers to support business continuity. And anyone who requires data to reside in Germany can use this particular service as well. Same goes with your China as well. There is an authority named your China 21 ViaNet. So China first foreign public cloud services provider in compliance and government authorities over here. So guys, over here, guys, you can certainly understand that what kind of the security is that you will be getting. Now guys, these are the things, guys. These are, you can say that complete, introduction related to the things that what we cover in our AZ 500, courses over here. Now, apart from that, guys, as this is the end of the module over here, so there are certain questions, guys. So I just want you to answer this particular question, because this is something what we have discussed. So guys, there has been an attack on your public facing website and your application resources has been overwhelmed and exhausted and now unavailable to users. What service should you use to prevent this type of attack? So this we have discussed, guys. I hope you will be able to answer.
I think DDoS.
Correct. Your DDoS protection. Correct. So your Azure AD is capable of providing which services? Guys, can you name some of the services over here?
Yeah, like MFA, self-service password reset, or...
These are features. These are no service. MFA is a...
Sorry.
service will be your SSO, service will be your B2B, B2C services. Yes. Right, these are the services available, and why? Where can you, obtain detail about your personal data Microsoft process and how Microsoft process it and for what purpose Microsoft is processing it? Trust Center, guys. Yeah, your privacy documents. Clear? Microsoft is pretty transparent. Remember, guys, we have discussed this over here. Privacy statement, Microsoft privacy statement, explain what data Microsoft is processing and how Microsoft process it and for what purpose Microsoft is processing it. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So, guys, any doubt, any queries related to the topics what we have covered, guys, do let me know.
Sir, can I ask? Hello?
Yeah, sir, go ahead. Hello. Yeah, I'm here.
Sir, according to, like you said, Germany has its own service, China has its own services. So, India has its own services?
See, understand this thing, right? I mean, why they have their own third party in order to manage, right? Because they don't share good relationship in terms of, what I can say, a political relationship with that particular country. And definitely in such kind of the requirements, you know, they have their own data center where they are managing, right? For the rest of the requirements, right? If you talk about the other nations, apart from these, Germany and, you can see over here, China, these are not required for the others, as you can see. So only this US DOD, that is your Department of Defense, right? That you have, Indian Defense System doesn't use Azure, guys, right? US Defense System uses Azure, and rest China and Germany, these are the regions which uses their third party organization to manage their private data center. They are using Azure, but those data center doesn't belongs to Microsoft. These are their private data center. Rest in India, we have West India, that is Bombay, Central India, that is Pune region, and South India, that is Chennai region. Microsoft has invested too much over here, and they have their own data centers where we are allowed to create resources, right? So there is no such challenge for Indian region that, you have to manage by your own. We are using Azure data centers over here. Clear?
Oh, okay, sir.
Okay. All right. Guys, any further questions? Anyone? Any doubt, any queries, guys?
Email.
All good? Guys, any questions you have, do let me know. Guys, just give me 1 minute. I think Shishadri will be joining in a while.
Sandeep, I'm here.
Yeah, Shishadri. Hi. Go ahead, Shishadri. All yours. Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Hey, guys. Hope I'm audible. My name is Shishadri. I look into the quality and training assessment in training solutions. So we are about to end the webinar. So just wanted to take the quick feedback from all of you. I hope the webinar went well as you expected, and it will be helpful to you. I would like to take a 2 minutes, to brief about our offerings. Already Sandeep might have explained you about that. Still, so Quinning has been into the training industry for more than 27 years, and we are known for offshore and onshore training, providers. So now presently we are also open for our classroom trainings as well as the online trainings as before. So if anyone has any interest related to any course, or if you have any inquiries related to any course, so please, I request you to please share me and your email address and the contact details. I have put my email ID and the contact details in the chat window. You can send us an inquiries where, I can fetch you all the details, whatever you're looking for. Even for the people who is confused, which course gonna be, right suitable for me. Even if you're not sure on that, you can write us an email. We can organize a dedicated tech call from our expertise trainers, who can assist you, who can guide you in choosing the right course. Okay. And all the details will be shared to you, and whatever the discussion you want to do for that, you can have in the call. All right, guys. Thank you so much. I have given my email ID and the contact details in the chat window. So in case for any assistance, or any inquiries, please feel free to reach us. Okay. And Simon, I think there is an inquiry from Simon. Simon will get a certificate of the sessions. Simon's certificate you'll be getting for the participation. If you want, you can send me an email. I have given my email address in the chat window. And for the exam voucher you will receive if you are taking any course. Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Sandeep.
Thanks, Shashadri. Thanks for joining. And guys, thanks a lot for your time and your patience. And we'll appreciate your time, guys. Thanks a lot for, you know, giving your valuable time and joining our webinar, guys. All the best and hopeful, you know, you will be able to find your fruitful requirements and the training within Quinnic. And all the best, guys.
Thank you.